Look at that view. We're here at the scenic Morgan Falls Hydroelectric Dam, located along the Chattahoochee River in Sandy Springs. The gravity-type dam and powerhouse built in the early 20th century was one of the first hydroelectric power projects in Georgia, and it's still in operation today, as part of Georgia Power's network of electricity-producing plants throughout the state. This is a great place to tell you about the law of conservation of energy, not to be confused with energy conservation. Energy conservation is what you do when you insulate your home and try to save energy, like heating and air conditioning. This is different. The law of conservation of energy is all about where energy comes from and where it goes. The law states that energy cannot be created or destroyed. It can just be converted from one form to another. So let's follow the energy.
I'm in the powerhouse of the plant that uses the stored energy of water in the reservoir to create electricity.
A large pipe carries water from the reservoir to turbines in the powerhouse. The flowing water turns a propeller-like water wheel or turbine, which is connected by a shaft to the generator, which spins and produces electricity. This turbine is normally underwater, but we've been given a look inside the penstock that houses the turbine. After the water spins in the turbine, it is discharged through a tube and returns unaltered to the river below the dam. The electricity produced by the spinning generator is conducted to the power transformer, where the voltage is increased. The high voltage electricity is fed into Georgia Power's transmission lines and distributed throughout the region. So how does this illustrate the law of conservation of energy? Water flowing through this plant is turning gravitational potential energy into kinetic energy and eventually into electricity. Remember the relationship between gravitational potential energy and kinetic energy when you have a falling object? Gravitational energy is transformed into an equal amount of kinetic energy. Here, however, it's not quite the case. Here, you end with less kinetic energy than the amount of gravitational potential energy you started with. But why is that? Where did that extra energy go? When water hits rocks, water scatters into a spray, and some of that energy is used to vaporize water into the atmosphere. The water also bumps into itself and the walls of the pipes, creating friction, which produces heat and sound energy as it flows. There's also friction within the generators as the electromagnets turn. The energy isn't lost, it's still there, but it's difficult to measure all of it, and it's not available for useful work. Non-conservative forces cause energy to be converted into forms that cannot be easily regained. Forces like friction, air resistance, and water resistance are non-conservative forces. They are more difficult to harness, making it hard to get them back in the form of usable work. Work done by non-conservative forces depends on the path taken. On the other hand, conservative forces cause energy to be converted into forms that can be regained. Examples are forces like gravity, spring force, and the electrostatic force. They do the same amount of work on an object being moved, no matter the path taken. For example, gravity does the same amount of work on the water moving through the dam, whether the spillway taking the water from the top to the bottom is a steep, straight shot or a shallow, curving flow before the water gets to the bottom, since the total vertical drop the water has traveled is the same. A long, curving path produces more friction, which is a non-conservative force, and thus produces wasted energy. Okay, so let's see why it's worth knowing about all of this. Let's say I want to know the velocity of this ball right before it hits the ground, the ball's maximum velocity before it comes to a stop. We could solve this problem using the kinematic equations we learned in other segments, but now let's explore another option to determine velocity. This time, we'll look at the energy relationship. Let's say I have a 1 kilogram ball in my hands standing at the top of this dam. We're on Earth, where the acceleration due to gravity is 9.8 meters per second squared. I'm holding the ball 17.0 meters above the Earth, the height of the dam. We know the gravitational potential energy is mass times the acceleration due to gravity times height. So the mass is 1 kilogram times the acceleration of gravity, 9.8 meters per second squared, times the height, which is 17.0 meters. The answer is 166.6 joules. And using significant digits, it's 167 joules. When I let go of the ball will start falling and accelerating. Now, a split second before the ball hits the bottom of the dam, how much potential energy is left? Well, the height now is zero. So put that in the equation, and the potential energy is zero. We know from the law of conservation of energy, energy can't be destroyed. So where did the energy go? Well, from another segment, you learned how gravitational potential energy can change into kinetic energy. So in this ideal world, all of the gravitational potential energy is converted to kinetic energy. We can use this to figure out the velocity of the ball right before it hit the ground. Let's assume we are only dealing with conservative forces. Gravitational potential energy being converted into kinetic energy with no work being done by friction. Using the law of conservation of energy, we can see that the total energy of the ball at its initial highest point is equal to the total energy at its final lowest point, or the initial gravitational potential energy plus initial kinetic energy equals the ball's final gravitational potential energy plus its final kinetic energy. So now, let's plug in the numbers we know so far. The ball's initial gravitational potential energy was calculated to be 167 joules. Remember the formula for kinetic energy. It's 1/2 times mass times velocity squared. Right before the ball is dropped, its kinetic energy is zero. It's zero because its initial velocity is zero. Right before it hits the ground, the ball has a gravitational potential energy of zero and has maximum kinetic energy. So, right before it hits the ground, the ball has a kinetic energy of 167 joules. To find the final velocity of the ball, we can plug in our equation for kinetic energy, setting that equal to 167 joules. The mass of the ball is 1 kilogram, and when you multiply it by 1/2, you get 167 joules equals 0.5 kilograms times the velocity squared. After dividing both sides by 0.5 kilograms, we can see that 334 joules per kilogram equals the final velocity squared. We then take the square root of both sides, and we see that the final velocity of the ball is 18.3 meters per second. You'll find in physics there are many approaches to the same problem. You're going to find that sometimes it's easier to use conservation of energy equations to figure out motion problems, especially if a ball doesn't fall straight down and instead zigzags to the ground. Using energy rather than tracking the path of the ball will make it that much easier. You have to love physics for that. For more practice problems on the conservation of energy, check out Our Closer Look. That's it for this segment of Physics in Motion. We'll see you next time.
For more practice problems, lab activities, and note-taking guides, check out the Physics in Motion Toolkit.